Okay, so this video is going to cover solving quadratic equations by factoring, specifically by using the zero factor property. So let's take a look at what we're going to be doing then. So if we're going to be solving a quadratic equation, first off, solving, which means we are actually calculating an answer when it comes to these equations here. So we do need to solve for x. Now, for the following examples, we're going to talk about solving them by factoring. Okay, so either we're going to be given a polynomial that will need to be factored, or every once in a while we may be given an example that looks like this one here that is already in factored form. Right, so this example here has already been factored. We have our two factors right over here, and they're set equal to zero. For an example like this one here, what we need to know is we need to know the zero factor property. And the zero factor property says this. The zero factor property states if we have an a times a b, which is just this right here could be our a, and our second factor right here can be a b. And notice these parentheses here around them, we are multiplying these two factors together. So we do have an a times a b, and it is set equal to zero. So then this says if we have a times b, then either a is equal to zero or b is equal to zero. So think about that. If we have a times b equals zero. Now, the only possible way that we can get zero when it comes to multiplication is if one of our factors is zero. Either a would be zero, so zero times b is zero, or b would be zero to have a times zero is zero. So one of these has to be a zero. Now, we don't know which one is, so what we do is we assume that they both are. So what we need to do then, figure out what would make these factors equal to zero, and what I mean by that. So if these equal zero, what we're going to do is we're going to split up these terms, right? Kind of separate them. So either x minus 5 is equal to zero, or x plus 8 is equal to zero. So since we don't know which one of these is true, we're going to assume both, so we're going to set both factors equal to zero, and what we're going to do is we're going to solve these equations. And they're just little one-step equations here, so taking a look at the left-hand side, x minus 5 equals zero. To get this solved for x, all we would have to do is get rid of that minus 5. So do the opposite and add 5 to both sides. On the left, negative 5 plus 5 cancels, giving us x is equal to 5. Over here on the right-hand side, we would just have to subtract 8 on both sides. On the left-hand side, 8 minus 8 cancels, and we have x is equal to a negative 8. These are our two solutions to our answers, and what they tell us is that if I plug in a 5 over there, or if I plug in a negative 8, that is what's going to make these factors equal to 0, therefore making this true. So, let's kind of summarize that into steps. So step one, if we are not given an example that's already factored for us, well, step one, we would have to factor it. Step two, after we have our factors here, what we do is we split them up into two separate little equations and set them equal to zero. Step three, solve these equations. And when we solve those equations, we will be left with our solutions. So here I have a solution of a negative 8 and also a 5. We typically put the answers in order from smallest to biggest. Okay, so here we have another example to solve. So again, let's go through our steps here. Step one, factor the polynomial. Here we're given an example that is already factored for us. So here we have two factors, so what we're going to do is we're going to split these factors up and set them equal to zero. So here we have x equals zero, and then we have 6x plus 36 equals to zero. Over here on the left-hand side, there's nothing to do there. It's already set equal to zero. There's nothing to solve, so we're done with that one. We can move straight over to the right-hand side over here, 6x plus 36 equals zero, and solve this equation. So Solving this equation, the first thing we would have to do is subtract 36 on both sides. On the left-hand side, 36 minus 36 would cancel, so drop down the 6x is equal to, well, 0 minus 36 is a negative 36. Last step here, we have the 6x, or 6 times x, so the opposite of multiplication is division, so we would divide both sides by 6. On the left, it would cancel, leaving us with x is equal to, well, negative 36 divided by 6. First off, a negative divided by a positive is negative, and 36 divided by 6 is 6. So over here, we get x is equal to a negative 6. So our solutions for this problem are a negative 6 and a 0. If we were to plug in a negative 6 into this factor, it's what would make that one equal 0. And if we were to plug in a 0 over here, it would make that 0, therefore making this a true equation. So here, negative 6, 0 are our solutions. Okay, so here we have another example, solving quadratic equations by factoring. Okay, so let's go through our steps. Step 1, factor the polynomial. So here we do have an example that is not given to us in factored form, which means we do need to factor it. So if we need to factor this, quick little check first. The first thing that we look for is, do we have a greatest common factor? So glancing over our terms here, we're dealing with a trinomial. So our first check, do we have a greatest common factor? We need to scan our polynomial and see, do we have anything in common? Is there anything in common with our numbers? Is there anything in common with our variables? Now, because we have this one in front, that kind of disregards our numbers. And because not all three of our terms have an x in them, then we can't have anything in common with our variables either. So for this particular one, we don't have anything, or we don't have a greatest common factor. Which means we can go straight to factoring it. So since we're dealing with a trinomial with a leading coefficient of 1, we are going to be using reverse FOIL. And remember, when it comes to reverse FOIL, in order to figure out what goes in these first spots, it's what times what is going to give us an x squared. And the only way to get an x squared is an x times an x. So then the next thing we would have to do is look at our last term, the 45. And what we need to do is we need to list all the possible factors of 45. So what would multiply to get 45? And the only factors are 1 times 45 and 5 times 9. And what we're looking for is which combination of these factors, the 1 and the 45, or the 5 and the 9, would add or subtract to get our middle coefficient, which is a 4. So the only possible way we could get a 4 by adding or subtracting is by using the 5 and the 9. And it would work because 9 minus 5 is 4. So I'm going to put the 5 in here and the 9 in over here. Again, remember, it doesn't matter where they go. It's more important which signs go in front of which number. And to figure out our signs, we need to remember two things. The first one, whatever sign our middle term is, our bigger number out of our factors has to have that sign. So since our middle term is positive, the bigger number out of 5 of 9, which is 9, has to be positive as well. Okay, so we just need to figure out what sign goes over here. So it's either going to be a plus or a minus. But we need to remember, these last spots here, right, they need to multiply to get negative 45, and they need to add to get 4. So would a positive 5 times a positive 9 get us a negative 45? Or would a negative 5 times a positive 9 get us a negative 45? Now, it would have to be the negative combination, and let's run that check just to be sure. Negative 5 times positive 9 is a negative 45, and a negative 5 plus 9 is a positive 4, so that does work. Okay, so now that we have it factored, we can finally move on to step 2, split our factors up and set them equal to 0. So here we have factors of x minus 5. And we're going to set that equal to 0. Then we have x plus 9, and we're going to set that equal to 0. Solve these equations. So on the left-hand side, add 5 to both sides. Negative 5 plus 5 cancels on the left, and we're left with x is equal to 5. On the right-hand side, we would just have to subtract that 9 on either side. On the left-hand side, 9 minus 9 cancels, drop down the x, and that is equal to a negative 9. So our two solutions, in order from smallest to biggest, are not negative 9 and a positive 5. Okay, so moving on to our next example here. So let's go through our steps. So step one, factor the polynomial. So when it comes to factoring, remember, our first check is always, do we have a greatest common factor? Comparing our terms here, well, first looking at our numbers, 36 and 25 don't have anything in common. I don't have a variable in each one of these terms, so no greatest common factor for this example. Then we would need to figure out, well, what factoring technique are we going to use? And typically the easiest thing or the easiest way to tell is how many terms do we have? Two terms is almost always difference of squares, three terms reverse FOIL or grouping, and then four terms is definitely grouping. So here we do have two terms, so if this is indeed difference of squares, remember it does come with three stipulations. First stipulation, we have two terms, which we can see here that we do. Second stipulation, they must have different signs. So the 36k squared is positive, the 25 is negative, so that works. Step three, they must be perfect squares. So in order for them to be perfect squares, okay, well, let's see if we can figure out if they are perfect squares. That means that we would have, looking at our first term, 36k squared, what times what would give us 36k squared, or what times itself would give us that? Well, what times what gives us 36? Well, 6 times itself gives us 36, and k times k gives us k squared. So that one is a perfect square. Moving over to our second term, 25, a 5 times 5 would give us a 25. So these are perfect squares, which means this is difference of squares, and difference of squares says that this is going to factor to your a plus your b and your a minus your b. So for this example, that would be 6k plus 5 and 6k minus 5. Step two, split your factors up and set them each equal to zero. So I'm going to take this 6k plus 5 and set that equal to zero, and take the 6k minus 5 and set that equal to zero. Step three, solve these equations. Solving the one on the left, our first step would be to subtract 5 on either side. 5 minus 5 cancels, leaving us with 6k is equal to the negative 5 over here. Next step, divide out the coefficient, and here we get that k is equal to a negative 5 sixths. Solving the equation on the right, so the first thing we would do here is add 5 to both sides. On the left, negative 5 plus 5 cancels, leaving us with 6k is equal to 5. Divide out the coefficient, and here we have that k is equal to a 5 6. So therefore, our solutions are a negative 5 6 and a positive 5 6. Fifth and final example is as follows. X squared minus x equals 20. Now, one thing that I haven't quite mentioned yet that we do need to be aware of is that when it comes to solving quadratic equations by factoring, we first want to make sure that our equation is in the proper form. And what I mean by that is that a typical quadratic equation looks like this. We have our x squared term followed by our x term followed by our constant, and it's set equal to zero. So this is what a quadratic equation looks like. Now, taking a look at our equation, it's not quite in the proper form. Notice it is not set equal to zero. So that means that we need to put our equation in the proper form, which means we need to scooch that 20 over to the other side so that our equation is set equal to zero. So in order to make that happen, we just need to subtract that 20 on both sides. Okay, so on the right-hand side, 20 minus 20 cancels, we get a 0. On the left-hand side, we had x squared minus x, and then we subtracted the 20. Now that our equation is in the proper form, now we can go through our steps of solving this by factoring. So step one, factor the polynomial. So in order to factor this polynomial, well, first off, do we have a greatest common factor? Skimming over these terms here, we do not. We don't have anything in common with the numbers or the variables. So that means that we can go straight to factoring. Now we have three terms in here. Our leading coefficient is 1, so I'm going to assume reverse FOIL method. So I'm going to draw my parentheses and set this equal to 0. All right, so that means we need to figure out what goes in these first spots here. So that comes from our first term in our equation, which is an x squared. And the only way to get an x squared is x times x. Then we need to glance at our last term, which is a 20. So if we have a 20, that means we need to list all the possible factors of a 20. 1 times 20, 2 times 10, 4 times 5. So we have three different combinations we're looking at. And remember, we need the one that adds or subtracts to get our middle coefficient, which is a 1. So the only one of these combinations of numbers over here would be the 4 and the 5, since a 5 minus 4 would give us a 1. So I'm going to put in the 4 here and the 5 here, and we need to worry about our signs. First off, whatever sign our middle term has, our bigger number has to have it, so I'm going to put that negative with the 5. Which means on the left-hand side, we need to figure out, is that a plus or is that a minus? So remember, this 4 times this 5 over here, they need to multiply to get negative 20, and they need to add to get a negative 1. So is a positive 4 times this negative 5 going to give us that negative 20? Or is a negative 4 times a negative 5 a negative 20? Well, a negative times a negative is positive, and I have a negative here, so that wouldn't work. But a positive times a negative, different signs does give me negative, so I would have to take the negative sign. Okay, so that means we're done with step one, factor the polynomial. Step two, split up your factors and set them each equal to 0. So that's going to give us x plus 4 equals 0 and x minus 5 equals 0. Solving these equations on the left-hand side, subtract 4 on either side to give us x is equal to a negative 4. On the right-hand side, add 5 to either side, and that's going to give us x is equal to a 5. So our two solutions, negative 4 and a 5.